message in recent years, and leading Hollywood figures frequently speak out for liberals and against conservatives, including the president. But the rest of America usually doesn't see things the same way. Our senior reporter Galen Tethrow has more on the gap between the Hollywood left and middle America.
In the 2000 elections, the Hollywood left actively campaigned for Democrats.
You know, we're national figures. All the people here are national figures, and our precinct is America, so this is our way of walking the precincts.
And more recently, actors like Sean Penn went to Iraq before the war there to oppose it.
People looking deeply into their conscience and really finding what their attitude is and speaking up about it.
And now with the 2004 election in sight, Oscar winner Michael Moore says the conservative George Bush is too stupid to debate a smart Democrat.
And I know you're thinking what I'm thinking, right? I want to see that debate. I want to see that debate.
Why is it that so many in Hollywood and the entertainment world seem to hate just about everything America does these days? And why is President Bush an evil, greedy, lying warmonger for just doing his job?
Saddam Hussein aids and protects terrorists, including members of Al-Qaeda.
This ad was part of a Hollywood-influenced competition for anti-Bush ads. This one won. Adolf Hitler was compared to George Bush in one of the other entries. But the public has to ask why it was fine for a liberal president like Bill Clinton to advocate ousting Saddam from Iraq, when it's wrong for President Bush to simply carry out that wish. So what qualifies the Hollywood left to speak out? Noble character qualities? Integrity? How much integrity was there in the standing ovation at last year's Oscars for confessed child rapist Roman Polanski? Harrison Ford accepted the award for Polanski, who skipped bail and fled the U.S. years ago. Perhaps they're qualified by their training to think through issues? They're good at emotions, but critics say rationality doesn't seem to be their strong point. For while those deep emotions make for cinematic stardom, when Martin Sheen uses fake blood to highlight his opposition to the military, they appear as cheap drama. And despite the stream of actors clamoring to promote a liberal agenda, not everyone in the public is convinced.
They're just actors. They don't even play themselves, you know what I mean? Their job is to be fake, to be someone else. Why would I listen to an actor?
Yet how many voters are susceptible to listening to celebrity liberalism? No one knows, but certainly the Hollywood left will continue to have influence over politics. At the same time, their influence on popular culture through the movies themselves looms as large as ever, for good or evil. Galen Tethrow, CBN News.
Thanks, Galen. Few people know Hollywood any better than Stephen Connell. He is the mastermind behind such television classics as The Rockford Files, The A-Teams, and, many, many others. He's done so many of these scripts that you can't count them all. He spent 35 years in Tinseltown, and he's still involved with projects with Fox and Disney, and he's also written a best-selling novel called The Vertical Coffin, which is, Stephen, it's so good to have you with
us. So good to be with you.
Thank you. Listen, I understand you grew up severe dyslexic. How does somebody that's dyslexic turn out to be the most famous writer in Hollywood? How'd you do it?
Well, it's just what I always wanted to be, was a writer, and I think if you pursue your goals, if you have something you really love, you know, I always say to people who are asking me, how do I get where I want to go, I always say, do what you love, you know, and don't worry about money. Money can't be the goal. It has to be, the joy has to be in the doing. And for me, that's what it was.
Of all those projects that you've done, which one, is any one that you really enjoyed more than any others?
Well, there were a lot of them that, you know, I mean, it's like picking children, you know, but certainly The Rockford Files was my first big hit. We all won Emmys. We were all close friends, still are. Yeah. You know, we just had Jim's 70th birthday party and everybody showed up. And
He's a great guy.
Yeah.
Well, that's so good.
Yeah.
Well, what about Hollywood? We're talking about Hollywood and the left. Are you into that crowd, or do you stand apart from some of this liberal wind that's blowing out there?
Well, I'm on the other side of the line. I'm a conservative. I'm a Republican. I was raised by Republicans, and You know, and so for me, you know, it's the other side. I mean, I support the president, and you know, and I have a lot of friends, and I must tell you, I mean, many that were in the clip there, Martin Sheen and Ted Danson, and a lot of friends were perceived as very liberal, but you know, and they're very nice people, and who want to have some say in the national discourse.
What is it? It's irrational. Some of these protests, some of the things they say, you know, are not founded in reality.
Well, you know what happens, Pat, when you hang out with people who all share your opinions.
Yeah.
That what happens is you start to develop up fantasies into realities, and you know, if you can say that President Bush is a traitor in your little cocktail party gathering and it plays fine, then you find yourself saying it on national television, and all of a sudden you're shocked to realize that not everybody shares that opinion.
Well, you know, it's amazing though. Clinton was the darling of Hollywood. They just idolized that guy.
Yeah.
What was it?
I think he was charming. He was as much of an actor as most actors, you know, in a lot of ways. He had a tremendous ability to communicate, not unlike Ronald Reagan. You know, he had that same ability to reach out through the television screen and grab you. And I think that, you know, endeared him to a lot of Hollywood people. And you know, and then he catered to them as well. You know, I mean, there was a saying that a lot of Hollywood people felt that political activism was a trip to the White House on Air Force One. You
know? And the Lincoln bedroom.
But you know, I mean, there was a lot of that going on during the Clinton era, and you know, and I think that was part of it too. And also, just one other thing is that in Hollywood, there's a big power elite, and power can be very seductive. And what of course, is more powerful than the President of the United States?
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, Kennedy certainly played to it, but apparently Kissinger that said that political power is the strongest aphrodisiac? I guess these young ladies are throwing themselves at the President as well, so it works up and down the line.
I guess so.
What's your next project? Are you out of television writing these days?
Yeah, pretty much. I'm trying to write my books, my novels. I've been writing some screenplays. You know, I'm really enjoying my life now. When I had six shows on the air, it was pretty hectic. And now,
honestly, how do you do it? I write some things, but I mean, how do you turn out so many scripts? How do you do it?
Well, it's like as I started by saying, I love it. And
well, I mean, I don't care if you love it or not.
Well, okay, then let me put it another way. If you do it for 5 hours every day, for 7 days a week, you'd be surprised how much you'll end up with at the end of your life.
Oh, you have to get up like 4 in the morning to make that happen.
I get up at 4:30, yeah.
Yeah, when I write, it's the same thing. I have to get up at 4:30 because you're quiet then.
And nobody bothers. Your phone doesn't ring.
Yeah.
My New York friends don't call me. That's the only
Listen, is there a formula for writing? I mean, you know, I see a lot of these shows that you get the writers and they just have a formula. I mean, after a while, you got the characters all delineated, so, you know, they write into the formula. But is there some formula for creating these things, writing these programs?
I mean, I don't know that there's a formula per se. I mean, there certainly is a three-act structure that I adhere very critically to. But beyond that, I want every show to be different. Certainly the A-Team was different from Baba Black Sheep or Rockford was different from Wise Guy. So I always try and, you know, and have each show be its own thing and not have a formula, because I think when you start to try and reproduce Friends and call it Couples, you know, what happens? Yeah. It fails, you know?
Sure.
So.
Well, it's one thing about writing fiction. You become like God. You can make the characters do anything you want to.
Not quite like God, Pat.
Well, not really. But you get a feeling that way, though. You're in charge of their lives and what's happening. But I guess you are somewhat limited. But it's fun doing it.
Oh, it's a great joy.
Yeah. Well, this book, Vertical Coffin. That is police slang for a doorway.
Yeah. This is about SWAT teams and. Yeah. And two SWAT teams that are basically in a war with each other after work over a fumbled warrant. That it's actually based on a real incident that took place in L.A.
Did they start shooting each other after?
No. Actually, what happened was that they served a warrant. A deputy died. The deputies got the warrant from the Treasury Department. They had not included all the information in the warrant, and it resulted in the death of this deputy. And so the anger that took place after that was so intense that I thought, well, it isn't too far. you know, to build that up into a SWAT war that takes place between these two agencies. But it's really, it's a story also about a man who's looking inside himself and trying to see. My hero in this book wants to do the right thing, and yet he's finding his life and police work to be very conflicted. So,
if there was a young aspiring writer watching this show right now, what would you tell him? Hey, this kid likes to write. He's in college or something. You're actually going to be lecturing at Regent University.
Oh, yeah.
What do you tell an aspiring writer?
I tell all potential writers to write every day. You know,
really?
And what happens is that writing becomes not a priority in your life. It becomes the last thing you do. You go to the movies, you play golf, you play tennis, you do your studies, you do your work if you have a job. And then if there's time, you write. I suggest you reverse that priority and say, the first thing I do every morning is I get up early, I set my alarm. When everybody else is asleep, I spend 2 hours, in my case it's five, writing every day. You'd be surprised how much better writer you're going to be at the end of the year if you do, if you write every day for 2 hours.
You find that it's sort of like a pump, that the creative juices begin to flow and things come out that surprise you.
Very much so. Yeah. You know, you find your characters talking to you. I don't let my characters run away with a play. I usually plot it up front and make sure I kind of end up where I start, where I want to end up. But I'm often very surprised at who the characters are when they start to talk.
Well, they do talk to you.
Oh, yeah. I'm just that crazy.
That's a true artist. Oh, that's marvelous. Steve, it's so good to have you with us. And thank you very much for what you're doing and the stand you take and your great creative work. It's just a massive achievement.
I'm looking forward to going through your university today and talking to your students.
Well, God bless you. Thank you. Terry, what's next?
Well, tomorrow on the 700 Club, the star of Mel Gibson's film The Passion reveals what it's like to step into the role of Jesus.